Hey everyone, and welcome to Sasquatch Theory. In this episode, I will be camping in the area I had my Bigfoot encounters. It's been a few years since I've seen them, but I know without a doubt, they are around. I will give you guys a closer look into my world and how the Sasquatch operate around human activity. Instead of just falling into the idea that this is just some unknown primate or demonic being, I plan on actually staying here and finding out for myself. Follow me as I face my fears and stay the night where I have seen the Sasquatch several times and look for answers for myself.
All right, this is my setup, and I'm gonna try to camp here tonight. I've been gifting in this area the past couple nights, and or actually this whole spring, but the past couple nights I've been getting some serious activity. The last time I was here, I got a stick that was poked into the ground, and I've been gifting at this little spot right here. It's hard to see, but there's like a little structure there, and there's all kinds of Sasquatch structures all around here. There's actually one right over here. It's like this triangle, and there's a bunch of arches that are like weaved into it. You can't see it from here, but I'll show you guys later. Alright, so what I have here is this tarp set up over a hammock, and yeah, I plan on staying the night here just because it's such beautiful weather today, and it's supposed to rain for like the next 3 weeks or so. But I've been getting activity here, and it's been happening probably since 2019, but in this particular area I started getting structures, and that happened last year in the summer, and I just started noticing all kinds of arches popping up and weird structures all around the area. And I know that because I used to hang out right here and just have these little camps, and they weren't around. Plus, after that, I've had my encounter sightings, and that confirmed it for me. So every time I see these structures, I know they're around. For example, like, I'd been gifting for a while, and I find this little stick structure right here in the middle of the trail, and the bark's kind of peeled off, and I think that's them letting me know that they're around, that they're the ones that have been taking the gifts. And I think it's just them letting me know that they appreciate it, kind of like them saying thank you. There's one arch. Doesn't really look like much. That's what I thought when I first saw it. And then I walked around. You see this other arch. By the way, these are all old, so they're like skeleton structures. They're falling apart. But like right there is the tip. And that actually broke not too long ago. But the tree was wrapped around that pine, and the tip was jabbed into the ground. And I thought, wow, okay, there's something. And then I look over here, and then I see this little A-frame, which there was an X right there. I'll show you guys here in a bit. And about three sapling trees that were arched, and one was woven around this pine. And it's still jabbed into the ground still to this day. Which, trees don't grow into the ground. And yeah, I understand that they grow arched sometimes when they're trying to like reach out for sunlight. For example, like that power line strip over there, you know, or any open area. But yeah, I've been gifting here, and you can see where small critters and whatever have been tearing it up. But I thought it was amazing because something had been taking the bananas, the apples, and peeling them. They would take the golf balls, the small rocks, the suckers. And last night I left the camera there. I put my little trail camera in there. I'll show you guys in a second. And something like reached in front of the camera. I don't think it was a little critter. It really could have been, but I just thought it was odd because it was facing directly where the object came from, and I feel like that camera would have snapped a picture of it. But the bananas were still there, which is unusual because every night something takes the bananas, and this basket's always tipped over. So we're gonna see what happens tonight. Yeah, you can hear a crotch rocket way off in the distance. That's actually a couple miles away. That's I-44. So anyways, we're gonna see what we can get to happen tonight. I don't think they're too happy about me putting the cameras there, but I feel like they're cool with it just because they know they're smarter than me. So it's no problem for them. I think if it continues, like if I'm always trying to trick them with the cameras, that might anger them, but I think I'm good to go. I got my shelter set up, and there's like property over there. I'm set up at the edge of the wood line. I know people are like, oh, you need to go super far. You need to go to the deepest parts of the woods. No. You want to set up at the edge of civilization where these things can come up to you. Because kind of like a buck when it's circling a food plot before he comes in, you know, he wants to get that wind. These things do the same thing, but they're checking out like your property. You know, it's the same deal. They're circling it. Sometimes they'll hang out for a little bit, do their thing, do some knocking, break some trees, and then they move on. Or, you know, they could stay for a long time. I anticipate that the Sasquatch are going to come in tonight, and it's going to be interesting. I wanted to try out a lot of this new gear that I got. Alright, so what I'm doing here is I'm placing a camera in here with this banana and these cookies. So we'll see what happens. I tried putting it up on a pine tree, but it just didn't work out too well, so I think this will work. They're either gonna take it or they're not, and they're most likely not, because they have this sense about them where they're gonna be like, no, screw that. I know you're trying to trick me. No animal wants to be tricked, because survival is the ultimate goal. But the idea is, when he comes up here, he's gonna look into the gift basket, and hopefully the camera will capture something. I really doubt it, but it's worth a shot, just because we can't sit back and not do anything and say, well, they're gonna know what we're gonna do. Because if that was the case, people wouldn't have eye sightings, people wouldn't catch these things screwing up. So we gotta try, people. You can't just be like, oh, they know IR, or they can see IR, so might as well not even try it. You don't know that, people. You're just assuming that. To me, it makes more sense they can just smell the camera, but or just get the sense that you're trying to screw them over. But it doesn't mean it's not possible.
Here is the footage from when I put the camera inside the gifting basket. Whatever reaches into the basket is very fast, has fur, and doesn't want to be seen on camera. Whatever it is, it takes the bread, the apples, and the cookies. This creature appears to be very cautious and avoids touching the bananas, which is weird because the camera is sitting on top of one of the bananas. In this next clip, you can tell the camera has been shifted around, and maybe the basket as well. You can also see maybe a bat or some type of nightly bird coming down and eating the scraps from the apple and the bread.
camera's still there. And the things have been messed with. Very interesting. I'm excited to see what got in there. Bananas are still there. So I'm assuming the Squatch didn't take it. Look at all this. What the heck is that? Well, I don't know. It's wild.
But yeah, there's the hammock. It's got like a mosquito net, which is pretty cool because the bugs are terrible out here in Missouri. And I mean, we got ticks, mosquitoes, spiders, centipedes, freaking everything you can think of. So you want to make sure that you got permethrin sprayed on your stuff or some type of bug spray. And yeah, mosquito net, that's pretty ideal. Which we're in the spring now, not even in the summertime, so it's only going to get worse. And over here we got this pond, so that kind of attracts the old skeeters, but we'll see what happens. And here I got my axe. I think it's in Ontario. I think that's what it's called. And this is like an Eberle stock bag. Basically, that's a dry bag, and it zips onto this frame. And then I added these pouches, which they're called batwing pouches. And they can hold a lot of gear. Like, I can stuff clothes in here, food, and maybe even a tripod. But the idea is to have a day camp pack that I can use to go camp in these areas where the Sasquatch are at. And I can have my hammock in there, my tarp, food, water, chair, camera gear, and it's just like a mobile camping setup, ready to go at any point in time. We'll see how it works out. I'm not really sure. Right now it's kind of janky, it's kind of thrown together, but when everything's in there and organized the way it should be, it works out pretty good. But yeah, that's one of the main reasons I'm camping tonight. Is I want to try out all this new gear. I have this night vision camera, which is this camera that I'm using, and all of this stuff is new. And I bought this specifically to go out looking for Sasquatch or for filming purposes. So we'll see what happens. All right, over here is my camera backpack. I got two Eberle stock bags there, which they can hold a lot of gear, and they kind of have like this foam padding, which helps protect all my stuff. It's got my GoPro strapped to the side, which is pretty cool because when I'm walking, I can film. And I can capture activity that's happening in my peripheral where I can't see. So I feel like that's important. I hear a lot of people say that, you know, they say put the GoPro on your backpack and face it behind you. And I've tried it before, but it's just a matter of getting the right setting on your GoPro. Because if you got a low frame rate, everything's going to look blurry. But if you got like 120 frames, you can really capture some fast moving stuff. And that's more of like an action setting. So like, let's say if a Sasquatch jumped up and started taking off running, if you got 120 frames per second, you're going to be able to capture that a lot better than if you got 30 frames per second. So in my opinion, it's a lot better to record in 1080 HD and just boost up the frame rate rather than being in 4 or 5K and then only having 30 frames per second. I guess that's good for like something that's close up and not moving very, very fast, but yeah, if you guys want to capture Sasquatch, bump up your frame rate. So yeah, I also have this Gerber knife. Came from Portland, Oregon, home of the Sasquatch. No, but for real, I hear there's a lot of Sasquatch activity in Oregon, which is Not surprising. This is a flashlight that I just bought. It's a Nightcore. And yeah, this is not a gear review video, but there's a lot of gear being used. So yeah, we're gonna hear background noises because there are people living around here. And that's kind of what I want to show, you know, that you don't have to be in the deepest areas to find Sasquatch activity. But yeah, this is a Nightcore flashlight that I got, and it's super bright. This flashlight is bright. It'll blind you. But anyways, it's got an IR setting on there that is perfect for night vision IR cameras. And I think it works pretty good. It's not too big. It's not too small. And it works really good. It comes with like a little holster deal to hold it and this clip, which I think is pretty cool. That way, if stuff gets too out of hand, you know, you got a bright light and you can actually blind something. And also, you can use it on your night vision gear, which is awesome. This isn't a gear review. I just wanted to show you guys like what I've done with the PayPal, the merchandise. Any money that I make off the channel is going back towards these videos and just trying to keep up with like different Bigfoot stories and chase people down and go to these properties and actually investigate. But yeah. So yeah, that's a pretty cool addition. I'm thinking it'll work out pretty well, hopefully. And this is like a little fold-out chair. I didn't use it tonight just because I got that chair right there. Oh, look at that. There's a freaking tick. That's what sucks about being out here is we're going to have to deal with all these things, which we don't want them around. Got a little temperature reader and a compass. We have a zoom. I think it's an H1 recorder. It's Molly Webb strapped to the side of the pack. And yeah, just a bunch of GoPro accessories in there. Extra space for a mic. I got the Rode mic in there. And I'm just testing out the mic, the onboard mic on this camera tonight, just because I want to see how good of a job it does. Because when I have that flashlight shoe mounted onto this camera, the IR light, I'm not gonna have any room for that Rode mic on here, so it's kind of a fine balance. But the good thing is the mic on here works out pretty good. Like, it's a Sony mic, so it picks up like noises that you did not know were there. Another new attachment that I got for the backpack is this spider holster, which is really cool because it's got a piece that connects to any of your cameras. Let's say a GoPro, and you just slide it into there and it clips down into there. And I think that's awesome because I only got my cell phone or my camera in my hand or in my backpack. And if something jumps up and runs away, you only got like a couple seconds. So by the time you get your phone out or whatever out of your backpack, it's gonna be gone. But with this, I always have my camera right there, so it's just like instant action. But this part also, I can't do this with the camera in my hand, but this thing comes out and it's like, I can't get it out right now. All right. No, we're gonna get this out. Okay, so this thing comes out and you can clip it to your belt. You can clip that thing to your belt, to the molly webbing on your backpack, and you'll have your camera hooked up into this little thing, and it won't fall out. It locks in, and when you want to pull it out, you just flip up that little lever. But yeah, as you're walking, this thing's on your belt, and you got your little camcorder or GoPro right there, ready to go, ready to fire. And then you can put this thing right back on your backpack, which I can't do it one-handed. I'm not going to do it one-handed because I don't want to damage my gear. just to show you guys, but there it is. Spider holster. So there's my tent right there. Not even 10 yards away. There's like this triangle structure. This is one of the ones that they, one of the structures that they put up last summer. And you can see like this oak tree that's bent with another tree laying over it. That one could have just fell. And then this hickory or walnut that's wrapped around those oaks. But that's like a pine tree, and it's like suspended off the ground, which is pretty cool. I have no idea what it means. I heard that the other structure over there next to my camp, that little one, means welcome friends. And it's got a bunch of arches, a little triangle, and an X. So I can only assume that this is friendly. Some type of communication for sure. And it's an instinctual language that they have within them because they don't have schools. Somehow they know this stuff automatically. But if we walk over here, here's something I want to point out. It's broken right there, which is kind of cool. But yeah, we walk back towards camp. And you can see where this trail's at. There's a structure right there. But also, if we go down this trail, probably another 20 yards, you'll see that weird tree right there. That little sapling, and it grew behind that pine tree. And it was jabbed into the ground at some point, but like I said, these are skeleton structures, so they're pretty brittle, and they're breaking apart. But you can see that is unusual. And I did find it. When I found it, it was fresh. But yeah, like I said, I just showed you guys the other two structures. Here's another one. And they all showed up around the same time. So you can see that break right there in the middle, forming a triangle. And then there's a pine tree that's laying out that way. But you can see this little sapling. If that tree fell, why didn't it catch the closer tree? The tree that's furthest away is the one that's arched into the structure. And again, I think this is some type of communication, but I do feel like, yeah, that's my knee popping. I do feel like they're trying to communicate with me in some way, because I've seen them and it seemed like they're observing me, like they're watching me, which I find kind of unsettling, just because these Sasquatch beings took an interest in me and they follow me all over the woods. And no, it's not like I'm seeing them everywhere, people. Like, you rarely will ever see these creatures, but it's the weird stuff you find and you experience along the way. I don't know. What do you guys think? Pretty cool, right? But yeah, it's getting ready to get dark, so I want to get back to my chair, kind of get a little bit more organized and prepared with the night vision. That way, when these things come in, I'll be ready. Last night, but it seemed like they were here around 8:30 or so at night, right after the sun went down. So I want to be ready, because right now is the time that animals start moving around. And I don't want to be out here talking and walking around the woods when that happens. I want to be sitting down. That way, whatever comes by doesn't see me as quick. I want to capture them before they capture me. That's the goal. All right, so let's go back. But yeah, that's my goal, is just to show you guys kind of what I'm working with, what I've been trying to do out here, and just what my goal is with the Bigfoot, just because I know they're around, and it's hard to wrap your mind around that, even if you know it. Even if you've physically seen these creatures, it's just something that takes a long time to download. But yeah, I know that they've been coming around, taking the gifts, checking out the area. The leaves are popping out, so I know they're going to want to be coming out. I think if you want to find Sasquatch activity, you can't just go out to the forest. You have to go where the Sasquatch are at. And that means you have to find some type of sign. You have to have some type of activity and basically frequent that area occasionally. You want to go there as much as possible and just be one with nature. I think that's the best way to go about it. And yeah, these basically what the Sasquatch are doing here is there's two large sections of woods, and basically they're coming from one creek bottom slash large section of woods, and then coming through these funnel points where people live, and then going to the next big section of woods. And I say that because that's what all the wildlife does around here, and they seem to use the same trails as all the other animals around here, and they just do the same things, except they're a lot more cunning comparative any deer, coyote that's out here. They know what's going on. The Sasquatch seem to have this sense about them where they know if you're trying to trick them or if something's up. Not all the time, but most of the time. Blue jays are going off. Normally that means there's an animal moving in the woods. Maybe they're just fussing at me. Could be. Yeah, they're fussing at me. But yeah, when you hear that out in the woods, deep out in the woods, something's coming. A lot of times deer hunters will listen to the blue jays and basically the blue jays are just giving up the positions of other animals. They're similar to crows, and yeah, they're pretty neat birds. They're just hanging around my camp. We hear you. They're letting the Sasquatch know that I'm over here. What a bunch of... That's how it works, though. You gotta pay attention to the wildlife because they can give you signs. Pay attention and read the animals. You can know that something's coming well before it comes. Here's this pond that I was talking about, and I'm gonna be probably about 50 yards from this little pond. hard to see from here, but it does hold water, and you guys will hear the bugs and frogs tonight. So, maybe when something's around, they'll shut up. This turkey just landed up in the tree over there. I thought it was a deer coming into that food plot. I was trying to find this track that I was literally looking at a couple hours ago, and I was thinking, man, is that a track or is that like a boot track? But it looked like there was toes in it. It didn't look too big of a track, maybe like 6 or 7 inches, but it had these definite toes to it. And I was in there just like doing circles trying to find it so I can film it, and I could hear this thing coming. But it was a turkey, and it flew up in the tree right in front of me, and I think I filmed that part. I was trying to find him, but I couldn't. And yeah, there's turkeys up in the trees right around us. I just saw a black shape again. This happened the other day. I saw a black shape go through there, and then I saw these deer jump up. They took off running a few seconds after that. And then I saw what looked like a few coyotes chasing it. But yeah, what I saw was an upright shadow swoop through there, but that's what I just saw. cuts the cider to go off. I flipped on my headlight, and the coyotes went off when I guess they saw my light or something. I made a little fire shortly after the coyotes went off because it seemed like every single critter was here. I literally just seen some turkey fly up in the trees right down there about 150 yards. And then we had some deer cross. We had all kinds of owls going off. And the coyotes went off, so there's all kinds of wildlife. It's almost completely dark outside. Alright, so I got the night vision on. And this is what it looks like without the IR flashlight. I don't want to aim it towards the fire because you don't want to aim an IR device into a bright light. But there's my camp. Oh, there's a whippoorwill going off. Very cool. But yeah, it's gonna look a lot better when I put that Nightcore IR light on the shoe mount and on top of this camera. I'm not gonna lie, all the sounds of the forest is pretty intimidating, but I'm close to home, so I'm not that worried about it. But this is a Sasquatch area, and I know that for sure because I'd seen them, like I told you guys. But it's nerving being in here, being in an area where you know you've seen Sasquatch frequent the area. I mean, I can't really tell you guys what that feels like. But this is my first time staying the night out here in these woods since I've had my eye sighting encounters. And I've tried to do it before, but I just wasn't feeling it, and there was just a lot of activity going on, and it just didn't feel right. Yeah, there's all kinds of animals out, but yeah, I mean, I've had a lot of time to think about my encounters, talk to a lot of other people about what I've had happen and what they've experienced as well, and I just feel a lot better about being out here with them. I don't feel like they're gonna try to snap my neck off, but it is a possibility. I think if they don't want me here in this area, they'll let me know it. But at the same time, how do you know if something's a threat or if it's just them being Sasquatch? We don't. We just kind of take the risk. But yeah, I'm enjoying my time out here. The weather's freaking awesome. And it's gonna start raining tomorrow night, so I wanted to get out here and enjoy the nice weather while we have it. Just because with the rain, I'm taking advantage of it and sitting inside, video editing, putting together some content for you guys. So yeah, I hope you guys enjoy it. Hope you guys enjoy this video. If you guys can, like and subscribe. And we'll try to get something. I mean, that's the best thing we can do, is just be out here. A lot of people say, where's the Sasquatch at? Where's the pictures? But that's not how it works. You can't just go in the woods and see a Sasquatch. Sometimes. Yeah, we'll put this camera up. Add more fuel to this fire because it's getting ready to go out. See what happens. All right, So this is the camera with the night vision. I definitely hear a sound back there. I've been hearing a sound back there. And that's with the infrared on. I think that's my brightest mode. Should be. Yeah, that's my brightest mode. So let's see what we can capture tonight. Tired of not getting any activity or not getting any evidence. Like, yeah, people have evidence here and there, but I want that Patterson-Gimlin film 2.0. Something sounds like it's cooking over there in the fire. I have no idea what it is. Maybe a rock is getting ready to explode. Hopefully not. Oh wow, you can see one of the structures from here. It's one of the reasons I didn't want to start a fire tonight. Because it's not good on the IR, but it's horrible on the audio. It's hard to hear stuff like on the mic when you got a fire hissing right next to you. Oh yeah, there's something over there on the other side. On the other side of that. I hear like one twig snap here and there, and it's gotten closer and closer. I think it's them. The last time I hit them with a spotlight, not an IR light, it was a spotlight, they acted like they weren't even being lit up. Like they paid no attention to it. And that I had the camcorder in the other hand. I just knew that the IR wasn't going to work. And at that time, I didn't know about IR flashlights. Just because with that Panasonic camera, it's really crappy. Oh, there's that other structure, I think. Let's see. Yeah, I believe that's that structure. So there's a Sasquatch structure. And there's my setup. Man, that IR light is bright. I wish I could see further past these trees here. With my other camera I can, but it's not very good quality like this one, so there's like an equal balance. Do you want quality, pretty good night vision, or do you want to see, I don't know, the other one's just not as good. Let's go check out this. Power line strip and see if we can see anything. Sorry. I'm having a hard time seeing where I'm going. Alright, so we're filming this power line strip. I'm just trying to gauge and see how far we can film with this camera. It's looking pretty good. And there's somebody's property back there. If there was a Sasquatch, I'd be able to see it. That's a good, I would say 200 or 300 yards away. Definitely over 200. Stars are out. Let's see what they look like.
be able to see them. Okay, well, you can see the power line strip. Or the power lines, pine trees, and the stars for sure, yeah.
So there was all kinds of wildlife out, bugs, some type of birds out, definitely whippoorwills, and deer, coyotes, and then everything just went silent, including the owls. It's just like dead silent. I mean, those owls were going off, but I keep hearing something right over here. But I keep hearing something right over here to the left of my campsite, and I'm not really sure what it is. I mean, I'm thinking it's them because I hear like a little stick break, and then a few minutes later it gets closer and I hear snap. You know how when somebody's sneaking up on you, I don't know, out in the woods, you can hear like a twig break, or like maybe when an animal's trying to be quiet, you hear just one little twig break, and that alerts you to their presence. That's kind of what I'm getting over here, but we'll see what it is. I just had to move away from that campfire because it was hissing so bad that I couldn't really tell what was going on around me. But yeah, I walked away and everything's dead silent, so we'll see what happens. I'll keep you guys tuned in. Maybe we can film some of these stars.
There is certainly something around my campsite, and I can't figure out what it is. I'm hearing noise over here by this structure and small stick breaks, and over where I showed you guys the structure, right down the trail, I'm hearing more stick breaks. And straight out in front of me, past the gifting site and the other structures, I'm hearing some stick breaks and movement. But I can't figure out what it is for sure.
You can definitely see pretty good with this camera. Yeah, I definitely think the Sasquatch are around. Just because, like I said, all the wildlife. And I keep getting these little sounds all around me. Which doesn't mean it's Sasquatch. I'm just saying, from my experience, that's how you know they're around you. You hear little sounds and they just sound off. It sounds like little birds out in the woods or squirrels around you, but you never see a squirrel. Unless, of course, you see a squirrel. But when you're having like the strange activity happen and you know that they're around, that's normally what they sound like. They basically just try to blend in with nature. So, I mean, yeah, they push over trees and they leave tracks that look like people tracks or boot tracks. So it is really hard to tell the difference with Sasquatch activity and human activity. But I think that's the name of their game. They try to do that. I wanted to talk about some equipment that I use out here and things that I think are important to bring out in the field with you. So, number one, you definitely want to bring a backpack and bring a water bottle. If you can, use some type of GPS system or download an app. Onyx Maps or Hunt Stand is a pretty good app. It kind of gives you your location in real time and you know where you're at. That way you don't get lost. Or you can just bring a compass. One way I know where I'm at is when I'm on these ridges, and this is just talking about the Ozarks. I don't know how the mountains are, or if you're out there in Alaska or Indonesia somewhere. If you're on a ridge, and let's say you're on the very top, follow it all the way down. Don't get off that ridge. Or if you get off to the right, just know if I get back to the very top and follow it back, I'll be able to find my way. But if you get away from landmarks, it's going to be really hard to know where you're at. But yeah, I mean, I think that's why the Sasquatch make their structures, because they travel through areas, and not to say they'll get lost, but they travel in clans and they want to be sure that they can keep together and communicate and let each other know where they've been and where they're going. I kind of think that's why the arches are bent in certain ways and trees are broke and pointed towards like civilization, parking lots, trails, whatever it may be. I think they're warning other Sasquatch of potential danger out in the forest, especially hunters. Hunters always get activity, and I think the Sasquatch are cautious of hunters because of the weapon that they carry, obviously, but they're very smart and they have some type of sense about them where they know if you're trying to trick them. So don't trick the Sasquatch. They know it. But yeah, it's important to have the backpack, water bottle, some type of way to know where you're navigating, and a camera. You want a camera if you're going to be out looking for Bigfoot. You can't worry about, well, the Sasquatch know that I have a camera, because that kind of defeats the whole purpose of being a human and having the opportunity to catch such a thing out in the woods. So if you're putting all your eggs in the basket of, I'm not going to bring a camera out there, your chances of having Sasquatch activity, in my opinion, don't rise. I mean, there's no difference between you being out there with no camera and you being out there with a camera. That's my opinion, and that's been from my experience, and I think it's been proven with people that catch these things on film. I mean, sometimes you catch them with their hands in their pants, and I think if you go out there looking for them without a camera, it's like they're gonna know what you're up to, so they're not gonna let you see them anyways. So either way, camera or no camera, they're gonna mess up. And isn't that the goal, to see one? Alright, so I just walked around and I keep hearing the same little twig snap. I mean, probably like 40, 50 yards right in there. And like I said, they don't seem to mind the camera. They don't seem to mind my presence. I think it's pretty cool, but most people don't believe me, or they think it's frightening, if that is the case. But, no, I wanted to mention, like, for those people that want to go out looking for Sasquatch, if you enjoy, like, wood knocking or calling to them, and that's your thing, go for it. I'm not going to slam you for it, and I've tried it a few times, and on video anyways, and I haven't really got too many results. I did one time at the Mark Twain, and I did have some activity happen when I was wood knocking and making calls at the Merrimack River. But I mean, out of the other 100 times that I've tried it, it doesn't seem like it works, but it can work. And I mean, I don't think you're an idiot if you do that. I don't think nobody should be calling anybody an idiot for wood knocking or people that are gifting. You know, if you're trying to find answers to what's going on out in the forest, I respect you for that. And I think we're all in this together, and it'd be cool if someone found something really cool. My goal of finding evidence, I already know there is evidence, but my goal is to get like that Patterson-Gimlin footage. I don't know, I think it'd be really cool to get like some type of new age film of a Sasquatch. Something really good. But I mean, a lot of people say somebody already has, but there's been a lot of controversy between that, and it's hard to say if that person really did get evidence, but I'm not saying they didn't. But yeah, whatever you guys want to do to find answers, that's cool. Just make sure you guys are safe and conscious of what's going on around you. I mean, there's all these missing 411 stories, and it's hard to say if it's actually Sasquatch or some type of unknown presence, or, you know, someone, I don't know, crazy people out in the woods. It's hard to say. Yeah, there's definitely noises going on around me. I can't say if it's Bigfoot activity, but there is something. Let's check the gift basket. Let's see what we got. I don't know if I should turn off this IR light. Alright. So, wow, it's really hard to walk through the woods at night, even though I'm looking through night vision. Let's Let's look at the gift basket. You never know. Oh, shoot.
Well,
okay.
Let's not try to break our neck. So there's two bananas in there. And, yeah, we'll see if anything takes the bananas. That sounded kind of wild. Something just threw a rock. There's something over there. Oh, I'm in a bad spot. That freaking tree's right there. Turned up the IR. We can see a little further for sure. A lot further. Damn it. Wish my knee wouldn't pop like that every time. Here.
something over there by my hammock. Whatever it was came down that way, started stomping, stopped, threw a rock, and now it's over here. Go over here and check out these structures, because that's where I was hearing the noise at. It just kind of sounded like a big animal showed up. A rock flew through the air, kind of bounced through some limbs, and it was just awkward. But before that I could hear like little limbs and twigs snapping. But now I'm on the other side of my hammock, and this is where I was hearing the noises from. So I want to go over here by this structure and kind of see if I can get a better look at what's going on.
It's very quiet in these woods. Okay, there's the structure. Major temperature change over here. Alright. Yeah, everything got quiet once I walked over here. If anybody knows what this structure means, comment down below.
So I never stood here at this structure area at night. I gotta admit, it's a pretty creepy feeling. And for how warm it was today, it's pretty cold now. And I think I'm about to call it a night. I'm pretty whooped, but I think as the temperature drops and I quiet down, there's going to be some animal movement coming down through this funnel area, and we'll see what happens. Like I said, I never tried out this gear. I have this hammock and this quilt blanket. It's a snug peck as well, so we'll see what happens. I just don't know if it's going to be warm enough. Maybe I need like the under quilt, but we'll try it out. We'll see what happens. And I don't know, I'll have my camera close by, so if something happens, I will spring up to action and try to record it. But I'm going to have to keep my camera in my backpack, unfortunately, just because I don't want it to get damaged with all the moisture out here. But I'll have it ready for the most part. It'll be right outside my hammock, so it'll just be a matter of unzipping my pack, pulling it out, and recording whatever the heck is going on. But yeah, we'll see what happens. So I mentioned on a recent episode that I want to find evidence, and there's been a lot of people in the comments saying it's already been found, they've already been proven, and that is true. Like, there is DNA, there's all kinds of videos out there, and the stories of people's accounts is undeniable. And I just want to get footage that is a lot better than the Patterson-Gimlin film. And I'm not trying to knock it at all, and it's really good. And I just want to get something that's HD. Something that's a little bit more relevant and up to date. Because they're out there and people have these encounters all the time. This is like a daily thing, but it's rare. You know, it happens here, it happens there. Basically every single county in almost all 50 states has a Sasquatch story and their own little history. But I want to find evidence. I want to get something good. The woods is quiet and I'm getting tired. I can barely hold this camera up. It's a heavy ass camera, so we'll have to work past that. But yeah, if you guys enjoy these types of videos, let me know down in the comments. I don't know. I figured I'd get out here and at least try. I get out a lot and walk around during the day, but it scares the crap out of me to camp out here where I've had my encounters. But I'm a lot more settled down now, so it's good. It's good. It's all good, guys.
I gotta look for snakes, sorry. I ran into a copperhead not too long ago right there. And I about stepped on him, so kind of freaks me out. I'm more worried about running into a copperhead than I am a Sasquatch, so. Well, I can't say that. But I don't want to get bit. It is a serious worry out here, so. Yeah, I got a lot colder. Earlier when I was setting up camp, I heard a few knocks, boom, 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 but I wasn't sure. It wasn't too loud, but they were solid knocks. I wasn't sure if it was like the neighbor, but I don't think it was. There's an old hunting blind that I got.
fell apart now, but...
try to film these stars, but I can't figure out like what type of setting I need.
So yeah, it's kind of weird. I keep hearing these noises around me, but every time I pull out the camera, the noises go silent, so it's hard to say. I kind of feel like it's them, just because as soon as the camera gets put away, I start hearing these little noises around me, and I can hear something walking out in front of me, but the moment I pull it out, everything goes silent. So I think I'm gonna call it a night and finally get into the hammock. I know I've said that a few times, but it's time. It's about midnight, and I just want to see what'll happen when I'm underneath a tarp inside the hammock, because I heard that Sasquatches will typically come out if you're in a tent or a hammock or even a hunting blind. So I think that's when I'll get most of the action, is when I'm most vulnerable. So we'll see what happens.
After a few hours, the activity seemed to die down, along with any nearby wildlife. The temperature changes and the forest becomes a quiet place of darkness. Whenever I investigated the sounds that were coming from the other side of my camp, everything went dead quiet for the rest of the night. I feel like I may have spooked whatever was around, and I probably should have just stayed put and stuck with the plan. My goal was to let them come into me, and not the other way around. The Sasquatch have a unique ability where they are able to calculate your every move and completely vanish without leaving a trace behind. I don't doubt the Sasquatch can see the infrared light, I just think sometimes when they are on a mission, it doesn't matter what you have in your hand. It could possibly be that they trust me as an individual, but also I noticed tons of little structures around the area, so that tells me there are juvenile Bigfoots in the area. Not to mention I've seen one, so it makes sense, in my mind anyways. Like I said, the activity completely died down, and I climb into my hammock for a much-needed night of rest. I did not hear any strange sounds, but in the morning, I am surprised by what I see in the gift basket.
Alright, that wasn't too bad. Let's go see what happened. Snug packed pillow did a great job. I just had to let most of the air out. And this under blanket worked out pretty good. Overall, pretty pleased with this hammock setup. Oh man. Woo. Good morning, everyone. So I did hear some strange noises last night, and it just seemed like something was observing me. And it didn't really make sense, because if it was a little critter, I feel like it would have got scared off by the fire and me walking around the woods, but the whole night it seemed like something was around in three different areas. There's one straight in front of me, one back here behind this thick stuff, and then one over here. So, I don't know, I just thought it was odd, because I would hear like a stick break, like, and
Before, I would never think that was much, but with my experience, I started noticing that the Sasquatch don't really make much noise when they're moving, unless they want to, and you'll know they're around because you'll hear like a small twig break. And no, that doesn't mean every sound you hear in the forest is Bigfoot. I just think if you know they're in the area, you know they're around, you just can't see them and you're wondering to yourself, man, where are they? Those little noises around you is most likely them watching you. Of course, along with wildlife as well, but it's all mixed together. And that's kind of what happened at the Mark Twain was we got a few knocks. They came into the property and they stood there and watched us for about 2 hours, and you could hear little twigs break. Snap, snap, and then knock, and then they'd push over trees. But I don't know, it's pretty cool, I think, just because they're letting me know they're around in a peaceful way. So I think that's pretty cool. What we're gonna do is we're gonna check the gift basket over there on the other side of my camp and see if they took the bananas. Maybe they came in. Who knows? We'll see. The apple's still there. I didn't film that last night, but before I went to bed, I put this apple in the chair. And it's still sitting there. Alright, let's go check the gift basket, just because there were two bananas in there. And I want to see if anything came in and got it, just because something has been taking the bananas and peeling them and just frequently taking them. Of course, they always take apples, but I just thought it was strange that they take bananas. Let's see what we got. All right, bananas are gone. Dang, I didn't even hear what came up last night and took this. Oh, there's a banana right there. Where's the other one? What the heck? Okay, see, check this out. See, I feel like if it would have been a small critter, it would be shredded, not like ripped open. See that? Isn't that weird? Isn't that weird? What do you guys think? Look at those bite marks or whatever. There's one, two, three. I don't know, maybe canines? I don't know, that's what I'm seeing, but it's just kind of strange because I feel like if a raccoon would have got into this, it would have chewed it apart, tore it up, and it wouldn't be so clean and split open. But I just got done telling you guys that I find them peeled, which is kind of weird. This one's more like pulled open from the middle or something, but normally I find them peeled just the same way a human would do it. I don't know. You guys around? This is kind of a weird structure right here, or I don't even know if that's a structure, but it's like a Y and just a stick, but who knows? I think it's them. Here's another weird thing. I don't know if they did this last night or if I did it when I was cleaning up this trail, but I don't think I did it because I remember throwing like these limbs just in an unorganized pile right here in front of this little structure. That way I didn't step on limbs on my way to the gift basket. But look at the pattern that these are in. I don't think I did that. And when I was walking to the path this morning, it was right there underneath this arch. So So yeah, that's unusual. That's not a stick poker right there. Well, it is, but it's part of that tree that's arched over. And that's the tip of it that was jabbed into the ground. There's all kinds of other arches around here. It just depends on what angle you look at it from. But yeah, we'll look around and see if we can find anything else unusual, and I'll keep you guys updated.
There's spider webs out right now. That's so annoying. But yeah, here's another arch. I don't know if you guys can see that. Kind of old now, but it was definitely them, in my opinion. Yeah, so whatever it was last night was staying behind this thick green stuff here, and I just couldn't see what it was even with the night vision. But I do feel like the night vision did an excellent job of filming. I mean, it looked to me like it was pretty good quality, but we'll have to review the footage today and see what happens. But it's getting ready to rain, and I mean pour, for like the next couple days, so I'm gonna pack my stuff up and get out of here. If you guys enjoyed this video, hit the like button, subscribe, and I appreciate you guys following along. Hopefully we catch more next time. But that's the way it goes. You don't just go out to the woods and see Bigfoot. You have to put some work into it, guys. So there's more of the little juvenile structures right here in front of the camp. And he's kind of got that going on all throughout this pine forest here. You can tell some turkeys literally just came through here. I must have still been sleeping when they've come through, because it looks pretty fresh. So I think these are the turkeys that were here last night. I saw them fly up into the pine trees over there. So they must have came down this morning. I mean, as soon as the sun came up and passed through this area. There's a golf ball right there. So one of the golf balls went missing out of the gift basket, and I just found it. It's on top of these leaves. Yeah, that's weird. I don't really see a small critter picking up a golf ball and moving it, because the gift basket is a pretty good distance away. And like I said, I know there are Sasquatch around here, so look at that. That's the family axe right there. But actually, that used to be arched a lot more, so the trees have kind of grown back up. There's another arch that's poked into the ground 100%. I guess I'll have to go over there and show you guys, because I'm right here anyways. But yeah, see all that? They've definitely been in this area at some point. But yeah, there's like the butt end of this tree. It's up pretty high, and it's wedged in between these trees, which are pulled over, and it's got another pine tree in there. But then there's this, I think it's a hickory tree. It's arched. And then the tip is in the ground. See that?
That's pretty amazing there, because trees do not grow back into the ground like this. There might be some experts out there that say otherwise, but my experience is they just don't do that. And you can see other arches around here. Alright, like I said, it's about to rain. So before I pack up, I have this apple that I left out last night and they never took it. I probably should have put it in the gift basket, but I'm gonna go ahead and put it in here right now as a thank you. Maybe it was them. I don't want to piss them off or let them think that I'm out here just to do them harm.